So we want to thank Mrs. Click and the campers and Mrs. Whitehead who played. I think, Joyce, you said you had over 50 campers this week. This is just a small representation of the kids who were part of music and puppet camp. So we're grateful to get a little flavor of that. And I, as the leader of a worship service, have to come to terms with the fact that the best thing in worship just happened. It's all downhill from here. No, just kidding. All right, we are glad you're here today, and we want to welcome you to this service of worship as we sing and read scripture and pray. And so I want to particularly welcome any of you who might be guests with us today. We're glad you're here. I'd like to invite everyone to stand as you're able, and we'll join together in our call to worship, which is printed on the front of your bulletin, or you can follow along on the screen. Wait for the Lord, wait with faith and hope. Wait for Christ's healing and strength. Waiting and hoping, we come to worship. If you would, remain standing as we sing our opening hymn, number 534, Be Still My Soul.
Thank you. for the opening prayer. Let us pray. Healing and healer God, call us to rise in faith this day. Strengthen us to walk into the light of your healing and your hope. Inspire us to trust your promises and celebrate the power of your steadfast love. In the healing name of Christ we pray. Amen. Please join me in greeting your neighbor. The Lord be with you.
Once again, I want to welcome you as we join in this time of worship, and would like to remind you, if you are at the end of the row, if you would take those blue pads, pass those down the row in turn for a way for us to know that you're here, but also there's an opportunity there if you have things you'd like to communicate to the pastors or the staff. If you are at home, you could do that by going on your smartphone with stmarkscarmel.org/attend. You could do that if you're in the room as well. We are having several things coming up that I'd like to highlight today, this afternoon. We do have a group that will be going to an Indianapolis Indians game, and I'm told the weather's going to clear and the game will go on, so feel free. If you want to do that, the group is going to be sitting together in the grass, and you can meet at the flagpole in the grass to do that. That was the instructions I was told. Also today we are having a blood drive, so there's still time after this service if you would like to donate blood. Even though we sign up ahead of time, there are usually open slots, so we want to invite you to head down to Wesley Hall and donate blood today. As we have been announcing, ever since COVID, there's been a significant shortage of blood in central Indiana. A week from tomorrow night, there is a VBS leaders training, Vacation Bible School leaders training, and that's my way of saying we need more leaders for Vacation Bible School. Right now we have about 175 kids who are registered for VBS, so we have a great group of kids. It takes quite a few volunteers to make that work, so I want to invite you to consider being a volunteer for Vacation Bible School, which will happen the second week in July. So if you are interested, you can go to stmarkscarmel.org and get more information. You could talk to Jackie or Jen, our children's ministry coordinators, or just send an email to kidschurch@stmarkscarmel.org. They'll give you more information. And we have several other mission activities. A couple of them we're going to highlight during the introduction to the offering, but right now I want to introduce Amy Adams, who is our missions coordinator. She's going to come and introduce a special guest.
Good morning. I am here to introduce our Connection Spotlight speaker for today. His name is Levi Wagner, and he is from Trinity Haven. Trinity Haven is the in-kind mission that we are supporting this month. In the blue section, you'll see there are a list of items that we're collecting. Any financial donations could also be made to the church, just denoting Trinity Haven in the memo line of either your check or online. But Levi's going to tell us a little bit more about Trinity Haven and what they offer there and how we can support them.
Hello everyone, my name is Levi Wagner and my pronouns are he and him. I am the director of programs at Trinity Haven. I was told that we go until about 2 o'clock this afternoon, so I've got some time. I said in the...
You go until about 2 o'clock, but...
They might not be here. Okay, great, good to know. I said in the 9:40 service that when I was 5, I announced to the world that I was going to be a pastor, so this is a really great opportunity for me. I do want to tell you a little bit about Trinity Haven today. We're a really new organization. We've only been around for about 3 years. But it's 3 years that have been full of a lot of growth. I want to start off with Matthew 25, verses 31 to 46. I'm not going to read it all to you because I really don't have that long. But it talks about when we get to heaven and that we're going to be asked, who did we help? And did we help the least of these? Did we help the homeless find homes? Did we help the naked find clothes? Did we help the hungry find food? And that's how we can share our Christian faith to those around us. And that's what you can do by connecting with Trinity Haven. So at Trinity Haven, we have two different programs where we serve 18 to 24-year-old LGBTQ youth. The first program that we have is a transitional living program. It's a physical house on the north side of Indianapolis. We can house up to 10 young people at a time. They get to live there for up to 2 years. And while they're there, we help them with interpersonal relationship skills. We help them with life skills. We help them finish their high school diplomas. We help them find jobs. And the goal is that when they leave our program at the end of that 2 years, or sooner if they're ready, that they can move on into stable, independent, and self-sufficient housing. They each get their own bedroom, they share a bathroom, and then they share all the rest of the house. It is a four-story house. It is over 100 years old, and we have great fun there. The other program that we have is our host home program, and it is unique in the entire country. There are maybe three host home programs similar to ours. And again, we work with 18 to 24-year-olds who are experiencing housing instability or homelessness because they're in the LGBTQ community. And we find people like you who are safe and supportive and affirming of queer youth and have an extra bedroom in your home, an extra room in your heart to let a young person come and live with you for about 6 months. 6 months is not a very long time to really rapidly change somebody's life, but we get that opportunity. And again, we provide that case management, that education and employment support. We also support our hosts. You would get to spend lots of time with me. But we also support our hosts financially because it takes money to add an extra person to your household. We're not asking for you to be parents. We're not asking for you to foster somebody. These are 18 to 24-year-olds. They're adults. We're asking you to be friends and roommates with these young people. If that's not your speed, if maybe that's a little too extreme, or you think, well, I don't have the space in my house, or maybe you travel a lot for work, we have lots of other ways that you can participate in Trinity Haven. We're always looking for people to come and mow the yard, wash windows, be mentors, be ambassadors for the work that we're doing. If any of that sounds like something that you would be interested in, I will be at a table in the back after the service. We also have very beautiful brochures that we worked really hard on. So please take a brochure. And I would love to have conversations with anybody about the work that we're doing and how you at St. Mark's can help us. Thank you.
Today's scripture lesson is 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 1 through 13, and you can follow along on the screen or on page 181 of the New Testament Bible in the pew. As we work together with him, we urge you also not to accept the grace of God in vain. For he says, at an acceptable time I have listened to you, and on a day of salvation I have helped you. See now, it is the acceptable time. See now is the day of salvation. We are putting no obstacle in anyone's way so that no fault may be found with our ministry. But as servants of God, we have commended ourselves in every way through great endurance in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, holiness of spirit, genuine love, truthful speech, and the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, in honor and dishonor, in ill repute and good repute, we are treated as impostors, and yet are true, as unknown and yet are well known, as dying and see we are alive, as punished and yet not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, as having nothing yet possessing everything. We have spoken frankly to you, Corinthians. Our heart is wide open to you. There is no restriction in our affections, but only in yours. In return, I speak as to children. Open wide your hearts also. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thank you, Lori and Kathy. As we move into our time of prayer, that meditation just kind of set the nice tone for us to pray together. We're going to begin our time of prayer with our breakthrough prayer, which is in the bulletin, and then we'll have a time of silence in which we can offer our individual petitions to God. and then I will lead us in a pastoral prayer and the Lord's Prayer. So if you would, let us begin by praying together the breakthrough prayer, which is in your bulletin or on the screen. Let us pray. God, open doors to reveal new hopes and dreams for St. Mark's and in our own lives. Give us the courage to follow where you lead. Amen. And now let us join together in a time of silent prayer. Together, let us bring our concerns for the world and for one another to God. God of the sky and sea, your world brims with glory. You have set us in the midst of a garden and trusted its tending to us. We pray for our good earth and the wisdom to care for it well, that generations to come may enjoy its fruits and revel in its beauty. God of the earthquake and the storm, your world is full of danger. Keep watch over your people and save them from despair. Strengthen and uphold them when trouble comes. God of power and might, the rulers of this world do not always seek your wisdom. Guide all nations in the ways of peace and uphold the oppressed, even as we work and wait for your coming realm. God of healing and comfort, pain and loss are all around. Soothe the frantic, embolden the fearful, ease the suffering of the sick. Give peace to all who grieve and hope to those facing death. All-knowing, all-loving God, we cannot always voice our hidden cares, but you hear our silent prayers, even those without words. With trust in your sustaining spirit, thanksgiving for your Son's interceding, and confidence in your coming realm of justice, peace, and love, we offer these prayers in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught his disciples and us to pray, saying, Our Father,
our mission focus for June is the Lucille Raines Residence. Since its inception in 1977, the Lucille Raines Residence has sought to be one of God's instruments to lift people up and help them rebuild their lives. It's a safe place for people recovering from addiction to establish a solid foundation from which to move forward in life. Contributions for the Lucille Raines Residence may be given online at stmarkscarmel.org/give or by using the offering envelope in the blue attendance pads. Also, during June, as we heard, we're collecting in-kind donations for Trinity Haven. It's located in Indianapolis. Trinity Haven is Indiana's first and only housing program for LGBTQ+ youth experiencing housing instability. Nearly 70% of LGBTQ youth experience homelessness, have been rejected by their families and forced out of their home by their parents, or they're fleeing mistreatment at home. Trinity Haven offers these youth a welcoming, safe, affirming housing with a caring community in which they can stay until they're able to secure housing on their own. For your convenience, postcards will list the requested items and a QR code for the Amazon wish list, and they're on the table in the gathering area. Children of the church are encouraged to help their parents shop for the items so that they learn the importance of giving to those in need. Kids can drop off their donations at the check-in for Kids Church. Because you give, St. Mark's gives. Let us pray. Creator God, we marvel in awe at the expansiveness of your creation. Your margins of diversity are boundless, and for that we thank you. Each of our beloved brothers and sisters are beautifully and wonderfully made, all in your image. Teach us to love people just as they are and embrace their identity fully as you have embraced us. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Amen.
Thank you.
I'd like to invite you to remain standing as we hear a story from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 4, beginning with verse 35. On that day, when evening had come, Jesus said to them, being his disciples, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Other boats were with him. A great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so that the boat was already being swamped. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion, and they woke him up and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" He woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." Then the wind ceased, and there was a dead calm. He said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. So last night I was reading over this story, as I often do, and kind of reading over my sermon, which is my practice before I go to sleep on Saturday night. I'm sure there aren't a lot of people in the room that read a sermon before they go to sleep at night. But on Saturday nights, that's what I do. So I have this in my mind, this story of the storm, and then about 6 a.m. this morning, or 5:45, I woke up to the sound of thunder and lightning and heavy rain, and I wasn't sure at first if I was dreaming from the night before or awake. But knowing that, or anticipating that we might have a storm this morning, I had made certain preparations yesterday afternoon. I made sure the cover was on our grill. I made sure that our patio furniture cushions were inside the house so they wouldn't get wet. We had our grandchildren's blow-up wading pool in the yard, and I took it down because a little while last year I left it up and a branch fell and punctured it, and that's not a good thing when you have a 3-year-old and a 7-year-old who's ready to get in water. So I made all of those preparations because I had some anticipation that there would be a storm. And that's what we do, isn't it? If we know there's going to be something coming up, we anticipate it, we prepare for it, we brace ourselves for it, we make provisions for it. But it's the unexpected that sometimes gets a hold of us and surprises us. It's those circumstances that give us some difficulties at times, and that's what was going on with Jesus and his disciples. Jesus had had a successful time of preaching and teaching and feeding the people, and he said, "Let's go to the other side of the Sea of Galilee," which is really a lake. If you've ever been to the Sea of Galilee, it's not really a sea. There's hardly any place in it, particularly in the northern part, where you can't see land. And so they decided to cross this lake. And in the middle, there was a storm. A few years ago, I traveled with our resident bishop, then Mike Coyner, to this. And Mike always called the Sea of Galilee a wide place in the Jordan River. The Jordan River comes in from the north, the sea is there, and then it goes out. The Jordan River exits in the south to eventually get to the Dead Sea. And he took a group of pilgrims out on a boat, and we crossed the northern edge of the Red Sea. And one of the boats, during their crossing, and he did two different groups. The first group, when they were crossing, they had a storm. And he had read this story, and they had this sudden rainstorm, and they got caught in it. So when it came time for the second group to go out, they had heard tell of this. And so they said, "Can you make sure there's a storm for us too?" But it doesn't work that way, right? Storms, in this case, come up unexpected. And so Jesus and his disciples are crossing the Sea of Galilee. They're going from one side to the other. They encounter this storm in the middle of the night. And the disciples are there in the boat. It's not a large boat. And Jesus is asleep. don't know what that. Jesus is asleep on some cushions in the front. Now, that's sort of reminiscent of another story, the story of Jonah and his companions. And in that story, Jonah's asleep. They wake him up. They discern that he's a problem, and they throw him overboard. So Jesus is probably not excited to recapitulate that story. But he wakes up, and the people, his disciples say, "Don't you even care about us? Here you are sleeping in the front of the boat." Now, you got to remember this. Several of Jesus' disciples were fishermen. So they had been out on the Sea of Galilee many, many times in similar boats. So this was not just a brief rainstorm that came up. It would have to be something serious for them to take note of it, to be frightened by it. And so they were in this boat, and they wake Jesus up, and they have this this moment. Now, in the Bible, there are two kinds of parables. There are parables that Jesus tells. So these are stories that are meant to have a moral. And then there are parables that are, in a sense, acted out. That they are scenes in which something happens, and the meaning of the story is meant to be more than just what happens. And this is one of those stories. So it's a story about Jesus and the disciples crossing the north part of the Sea of Galilee, but it's more than just a story about that. We are meant to interpret this story in more ways than just that. And in order to do that, we have to have some understanding of how the Hebrew understanding of the sea and water, which is begins with the creation story in Genesis, where the sea is seen as chaos, and God creates land and other things out of this chaos, which is the sea. And over the centuries, the interpretation or the view of the sea for in Hebrew scriptures kind of developed into that's where evil things lived and like demons and so forth. And in the stories immediately before and after this, Jesus is exorcising demons. So this is kind of a prelude to a story that will happen on the other side of the Sea of Galilee. As a matter of fact, when Jesus wakes up and he says, "Peace, be still," it's the same word that he uses in a few verses later when he's calling out a demon from the Gerasene demoniac. So there is more to the story than just what's going on in the story. However, there is also a lot going on in the story. Jesus wakes up. One of the most common phrases in the New Testament is, "Be not afraid." Do not be afraid. And so here in this story, Jesus said, "Are you still afraid? Are you still not confident that I will take care of you?" How many of you have dogs? A good number of people, not everybody, but a good number of people have dogs. And so one of the things that I've learned as a dog owner is that you have to prepare for the 4th of July. Because in my neighborhood, we live in a cul-de-sac, and our cul-de-sac always has fireworks dinner. They have a neighborhood, a little firework display. They're always inviting us to it, and we always say we can't because we have to sit with Bo. We have to let him know that it's going to be okay. Now, he is in no danger whatsoever, but he doesn't know that. And so we say to him, "It's okay." We comfort him and be with him. In a lot of ways, I find this moment with Jesus and the disciples a lot like that. With Jesus there, they're really in no danger, but they don't know that. Jesus knows that. And so he kind of chides them and said, "Are you still afraid even though I am here with you? I'm here and I tell you, it's going to be okay. It's going to be all right." It's not that he's uncaring. It's that he sees the bigger picture. And sometimes we need to be aware of that bigger picture as we think about what it means to navigate difficult times in our lives. All of us have experienced difficulties that were unexpected. All of us have had those times when we think maybe God is asleep or not paying attention or not caring, where are you, God, in the midst of this difficulty that I'm experiencing? All of us have had those times when we feel like we're on a boat and it's about ready to go under, and we wonder how we are going to escape tragedy in this moment. And so there is a larger way that in this story we see a lesson about the providence of God. The early church, in interpreting this story, often interpreted it as the church being the boat in the boat with Jesus, and that the storm and the surroundings being the hostile world that was threatening their existence and their well-being. However you interpret it, either as just a story or as a parable that is more than the story, the lesson is that in Jesus' care, they would be okay, and that we too experience that. One of the features of this story that makes it an important story for as well, that kind of foreshadows some other things in the New Testament, is that if this story happened in the Old Testament, there was a pattern where people would be in distress and there would be a prophet among the people, and the people would say to the prophet, "Can you intercede for us before God?" And the prophet would pray to God, and God would then respond to that. But what is different about this story is when the disciples wake Jesus up, Jesus doesn't cry out to God. So the typical pattern where the prophet would say, "Oh God, please watch over us, please take care of us." Jesus instead just calms the sea. So this is one of those moments where you begin to see that Jesus is more than just a human prophet, that he is in fact the presence of God in a way that is unexpected and unprecedented up until this point. That he doesn't have to evoke the presence of God. He is the presence of God for the disciples in that moment. And he calms the sea and assuages their fears. And so for us as well, we experience that. When I was reading and studying for this, another thing the commentators pointed out is when you cross the Sea of Galilee here, you do more than just cross a body of water, that you actually go from one culture to another culture. That in this time, Jesus went from the familiarity of his home culture near Capernaum to an unfamiliar culture where they would tend swine, which they wouldn't have done in his hometown, that there were other cultural differences. So it's symbolic as well as not only that Jesus and his disciples are crossing this water, but they are going from the familiar to the unfamiliar. They're going from their people to the other people. They are expanding the ministry of Jesus Christ from those in his hometown to those who might be different and other than they were. And in that sense as well, we get this parable of the expanding ministry of Jesus as they are moving from his hometown to the broader world. And it calls us out of our complacency, all of our familiarity, out of our comfort to do that as well. Jesus rebukes the wind. And you would think that after the wind had been calmed, that the disciples would say, "Hallelujah, thank you." But as was often the case in the Psalms when things like that happen. But in this case, it says that the disciples were afraid, that they had a fear because they weren't sure what was happening in this situation. And sometimes we are afraid as well, even though Jesus says, "Be not afraid." We are afraid because of the uncertainty of those things we face. So for Mark, the key point here is that the person who will later be crucified is the person who, without prayer to God, has successfully commanded the wind and the sea. He is a divine person who represents the one true God. It is a foreshadowing that Jesus is more than they could have ever imagined. So what is the end of this story? That is that after Jesus is awake, he calls the disciples away from their fear into what comes next. And so we too have to imagine, what is God calling us to? What bodies of water are we meant to cross? What uncertainties are we meant to face? What dangers are we meant to navigate with the presence and power of God in order to follow Jesus where Jesus calls us to go? As I think about this story, I am reminded there are times when we have to cross uncertain waters. There are times when God calls us forward into new ideas and new things. And sometimes that is a frightening and daunting experience. But in this story and in the presence of Jesus Christ, we know that we don't face those experiences alone. That like the sea, Jesus brings peace in the midst of all of the endeavors that we have in God's name. And so I want us invite us today to consider, where are the places in our lives where we find distress? Where are the places in our lives where maybe it seems a little stormy, where the water's a little choppy? And what does it mean for us to invite the presence of Jesus Christ into those moments to bring peace and power into our futures? And then, how can we help bring that peace and presence of God's Holy Spirit into other people's lives? Let us pray. Almighty and holy God, we do thank you for the power and presence of your Holy Spirit. We thank you for Jesus calming the storm. And we thank you for those times when you calm the storms in our lives. We pray, O God, that you might give us courage, and that you might give us a sense of your Holy Spirit watching over us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Now I want to invite you to stand as you're able, and we'll sing together a song of peace that reminds us that not only does God bring peace into our lives, but we then are agents of God's peace in the world. And now go out to be Christ's hands and feet, and do not be afraid. The Creator of all that is upholds your life. Christ himself walks beside your side, and the Spirit gives you breath to speak God's grace and sing God's praise. Amen.